And I'm Rob.
I am Rob. Hello, guys. Today we are, this is a session on metrics that matter. This is a beginner session, and it is essentially work that both Raj and myself have done at a pretty highly regulated, in a highly regulated federal environment. So we're going to share with you some information today. So.
Things that work, things that didn't work. The agenda is, we'll just get started by talking a little bit about the what and why of measurement, what are metrics, and then see how, at least our experience with how we apply metrics in a deliberate manner towards some of the outcomes that we were looking for that I'll share with you, that both Rob and I will share with you in this session. And finally, some key takeaways. Obviously, there's lots and lots of metrics and measures these days, but what we will talk about is some of the measures that we use, and then leave you with other metrics that other organizations are using. Right? There's no one set of measures and metrics that is applicable to every domain, but perhaps through the discussion, we can at least expose you to things that work for us, perhaps that we use. And somebody else told me, multiple folks said that they just came from a session where it was all about, don't track anything. This is fine, but this is something that's going for us. So. And the context, you want to keep that in mind. This is a very, very large federal program, lots of regulation, Congress involved, and so forth. So we have to have some deliberate way of tracking our work. So that's the context and the agenda. So first and foremost, as we get started, I'm going to ask you guys, the audience, to tell me, what does done mean in today's lean, agile, DevOps-inspired world? Right? We are, of course, in a DevOps track. What does that mean?
Shippable
to? And yeah, all the way to production, putting code in the hands of the customers. And what are the implications of that notion of being done? What are some of the implications of saying, I am done when my code from idea to customer, it's in the hands of the customer, shippable. What are the implications of that? Yeah, that's all the nice theoretical stuff. Value is the only thing that matters. It's in the hands of the customers, feedback, all that good stuff. But the implications from a delivery perspective, testing and operations perspective, the implications are we need to be sure that when the code hits the customer, how's it going to react? Is it really ready? Right? Software development inherently is a non-deterministic activity. Right? There's lots of uncertainties. Now, when your definition of done within our DevOps context is code in the hands of the customer, the questions really are, how do we minimize some of those uncertainties? There are uncertainties, of course. Now, they just make it that much worse in this today's world of continuous delivery, continuous deployment, continuous operation. So one way to perhaps minimize all these uncertainties, maybe, and this is not
working,
is through some way of measurement. Measurement is essentially about collecting data, observing a certain problem space to draw some insights. A measurement cannot solve the problem for you. All it can do is shed some light in a certain context. That's all it can do. The insights and the actions determine how you're going to react to those measurements. Just a little bit of theoretical constructs here, because often these terms are sort of misused and misrepresented. Measurement can come in two forms. Measures are concrete things, usually quantitative, and they're applied to one thing. I have 5 apps. Number of production data. Right? These are examples of measures. Metrics, on the other hand, are usually comparative in nature, ratios. You're essentially targeting two different dimensions, meaning looking at the same measure of I have 5 apples, a metric may be I have 10 apples more than yesterday, or in terms of incidents, instead of just being a concrete number, the number of incidents, a metric may be number of 7 incidents since my last trip. You're always playing more than one dimension when you talk about a metric, right? Comparative in nature. Now, when you talk about metrics, as you mentioned, you are in lots of sessions, they talk about metrics are bad, metrics are evil. So I want your perspective. How many of you are doing some sort of measurement, either through measures or metrics in your organization? And well, lots of folks, right? So Are they all evil?
No.
Few are evil. Can you give me an example of evil metric?
Productivity.
Targeting an individual. Right? You're targeting. It's a necessary evil, it says. But there's lots of debate about metrics being evil, and also that metrics can be gained. Absolutely. Right? Metrics can be misused, metrics can be gained. No doubt about it. No matter what sort of metric you use. But that doesn't necessarily mean metrics are all bad. It's in the context of how you use them. What's an example of where you could potentially game a metric? Anybody? Probably happened within your team.
Code coverage.
Thank you so much, right? Instead of this high watermark say that, I'm going to fail my build if it doesn't hit 95% unit test coverage. What do you think is going to happen? Yeah, or just the bogus assert true, right? It's very easy to game numbers, right? So there's a certain way you can use these metrics where it's not that it can't be gameable, but at least that you're going to try to use them in a manner where it's actually relevant to the organization. So this is some of the challenge that we face, and we'll sort of walk through some of the measures and how we try to make sure that it wasn't gamed and not being misused. So a good heart flaw is a law that's out there. It really says when a measure becomes a target, it ceases to be a good measure. What Goodhart is really saying is, if the measure itself, the metric itself, becomes the goal unto itself, you've completely lost its value. And this is a powerful concept that he mentioned, and something that we ought to keep in mind, right? If test coverage is the end goal, it's useless as a measure, right? It's a measurement towards something large, right? And that should be the context for all of our, as we design our metrics for our organization. So, having said that, what are examples of, so what makes for a good metric? Anybody know some ideas? What makes for a good metric? You said you guys are all measuring some sort of thing. What metrics made sense? I don't want the actual metric itself. What was it about the measure that made it more valuable than someone comes to
make? Makes us learn. What?
Makes us learn. Makes us learn, okay. Something that's helping us change behavior in some sort, yeah.
Generates insights.
Yes, that's the point of metrics, is to generate insights.
Identify a potential problem.
Indicate a general area, zone of disturbance, as they call it. So simple, now you guys are on a roll here. So that's good. So some characteristics of a good metric are, first and foremost, is it easily understood? If it requires a PhD to decipher the metric, it's sort of useless, right? Especially for leadership, you want metrics that make sense, because oftentimes there's a tension between the development teams and leadership who can support us, but also the metrics have to help cater both needs. Comparative metrics. At least we find that the metrics are a ratio of some sort. They're always trying to balance a measure against a different dimension. Maybe it's over time. Maybe it's comparing user cohorts. Always ratcheting up tension between two dimensions to us feels like it's a much more relevant measure than a plain number. So, as an example, if I say I have 10% more unit test coverage than last sprint, that's perhaps to me more meaningful than saying right now our test coverage number is 32%. That doesn't give me the context as to in terms of are we progressing, are we digressing, you don't know, right? Comparative measures are more useful. Last but not least, the most important criteria when designing metrics and choosing metrics is it going to change the behavior of teams and individuals? This has to be one of your primary criteria when you're sort of choosing your metrics. So, having said that, if we look at examples of characteristics of a good measure, I can tell you from at least the experience that we've had is you can have design all the beautiful metrics that you want in measures, but if it's not aligned towards some larger business goal or outcome, it's completely useless. Meaning that you have to start with identifying what specific business goal or outcome that we're trying to reach, and then design your metrics, because then they will provide you the gauge. Are you progressing towards this given goal, or are we sort of digressing? Right? This has to be your starting point when you start talking about designing metrics. So having said that, there are some guidances at least that we'd like to share with you in terms of what are the key dimensions across which you might want to design your metrics, and how would these various dimensions compete with each other as you're designing the metrics. And we'll sort of go through some of those dimensions and key metrics.
Great. Thanks, Raj. So as Raj stated, I'm sure most folks have seen this before, moving from essentially left to right from a pipeline perspective. We've tried to organize this because this is sort of DevOps day here at Agile India. So again, we tried to provide a topology to go over some of these key drivers and metrics. We'll break this topology down into some of these really four success factors and dive in again some specific metrics that you may take home and reuse and hopefully stimulate some further thought. So first would be, as Raj has already stated, would be our business success. This being one of our drivers, right? Business success meaning, exactly, if we look at this image here below, in a lot of new companies or startups or whatever else, there's a lot of impetus, a lot of action just to do something, and then something will happen afterwards. Right, so I'm going to build some awesome thing and something will happen. Typically, there's a lot of sort of afterthought and forward, sort of back-looking. Again, to Raj's point, we want to think about what are we trying to measure from the business perspective? What objectives are we actually looking to measure against? So it could be something like a market share, or it could be something like new business service enablement. These are sort of key indicators of success from the business perspective. Again, should be tied to some sort of measurable objective. Again, too often, a lot of companies, even mature companies, as we've seen in certain projects or initiatives, they fail to actually tie any sort of metric or measurement to what they're starting off with. And essentially, there's, again, in phase two, it's a big question mark. What happened? What are we actually going to accomplish? How would we get there? So here is actually some data that we would like to share. Again, the data we're going to show you here are examples that we've derived from, again, a pretty highly regulated federal environment to help illustrate some of these factors.
So this is a pretty simple, straightforward example. You're all probably familiar with burnout charts, right? Burnout charts. This is just an example of a burnout chart. And our goal, just to go back to the previous slide, is we wanted to increase, we were digitizing a whole bunch of paper forms in the federal sector, and our business motivation was really to digitize as much as we can with a high quality, because for the general public, and the question really was, we had 150 developers in one specific project, on a shared code base, how do we really track the work that's being done? We started off with the basic burnout chart. But what we noticed is there wasn't enough interaction by our leadership as well as the teams in terms of interacting with this burnout chart. We have the accumulated number of stories, we have our sprints, and things are happening. Each sprint, work is being done. And what we realized is this is not really helping the organization a whole lot. All it was doing was just saying, okay, there's more data, so what? We took an example from Spotify, the music streaming service, and that was essentially for every time we produce a burnout chart, we also, in our program area, answered three questions. And this was live data all the time. The three questions were, when will all the planned stories be completed? And the second question is, what is the total number of stories estimated? Will they be complete? What number of stories will be completed by a given date? And the third one is, can we deliver all the plan stories by a given date? Right? If you look at these three questions, the first question is asking the question of fixed scope. When are all the plan stories going to be completed? Right? It's a fixed scope question. Based on the trend lines, you guys are all familiar with your burn-up charts, we just say, okay, it's going to be done in sprint 90. The second question answers this. It is fixed date. If I have to deliver something by such and such date, what will get done? So that's a fixed date, flexible scope question. And again, based on the same trend lines, we're able to answer, you know, we can get about 120 stories cumulatively done based on the average. And finally, the last question is a question of fixed scope and fixed date, right? Usually, management is interested in this sort of stuff. I want all of this, or I want it done by this date, right? And clearly, based on our trend lines, nope, that's not possible, right? So making little adaptations to simple charts like what most of us are familiar with actually completely change the dynamic and our conversations with management, right? Because this is simple for them to understand. And so again, these burn-up charts and burn-down charts, and this fosters a deeper conversation. Okay, we can't get done, but what can we get done? So meaningful conversations just by making these subtle changes.
So again, just to wrap up on business success, I mean, we're talking about business outcomes, identifying what those key indicators of success are, and they could be varied depending upon, again, the maturity of your company, maturity of your product, and they can actually drive certain, again, from key indicators, they can actually drive how you're going to shape, which way you're going to move, as Roger's already stated in this example, to, you know, if it's a new company, you're probably going to be focusing more on stability and getting things rolling. If you're sort of a more mature, you may be focusing on more efficiency of your resources, being more innovative. Again, having some of these outcomes with your key indicators aligned properly can help drive the future state. So the next sort of from our topology, the next sort of driver here is customer/user success. Again, this is everybody's had some level of dealing with a customer, has had some interface or action in dealing with service desk responses. Some of these results here could even be, from a DevOps perspective, getting data from our customers, for example, from our A/B test results, actually putting something out for specific testing, canary releases as well, receiving some sort of feedback from our customers. Customer ticket volume is also a very good metric that we probably use pervasively across, not just from the development perspective, but again from the operations perspective. We have to actually tie or actually have to rely on a new group or a team to receive these types of tickets or requests, and then ultimately from a development perspective, we're the folks that end up having to deal with fixing those challenges. This is something we want to track, maintain, and ensure that we have the capability to continue to enhance and make those volumes either decrease or responses decrease. So the data that we're showing here, again, this is from a pretty highly regulated federal environment. As you can see, we've got pending, this is improving responsiveness to our issues. The challenge was we were having a lot of tickets come in on this certain project, and a lot of the tickets were coming in. They weren't being resolved in any sort of manner that was quickly. We ended up stating to the actual development teams, as opposed to proxying this off to some tier one support crew, devs, as you move forward, you guys are going to own your work, this work, as it moves to production. Not only that, but you now are going to put a pager on your side and on your belt, and you're going to be tier one in some sort of manner. So the dynamics changed for these folks working and having to reschedule themselves in a queuing perspective, setting up a schedule, so they were able to actually respond from a front line to any issues. As you can see from this, both of these products, as we progress with a you build it, you own it mentality, you can see our pending dropped dramatically over time, almost almost becoming completely equatable to having almost near time resolution of those tickets.
Shed light on the problem. Trying to get out more capability in isolation, not worrying about its, the manifest defects downstream, is pointless. So this of course there was a lot of pushback from the team saying, you know, all I want to do is crank out some code, right? Sure. But also if it's not really enabling customer satisfaction, improving that, perhaps we've got to do something about it. So by the same token, we have to provide some defenses for our team as well. You can't say you're going to build all the new features. Oh, and by the way, you're also responsible for tier 1 support for the features you're putting into production. You have to, they have a capacity, that's their capacity. You have to make sure that you're balancing this kind of work along with the feature work that they're doing. And that's the setup of the management. And again, we're using some sort of data to illuminate that this is what the team is doing. If you want improve customer satisfaction, perhaps you've got to ratchet down your desire for new capabilities possible.
Again, from efficiencies, from staffing, hiring the right talent, these are all indicators of success. So there's a lot of different metrics that you can move forward with. I'd like to take the opportunity of something I've read recently. This was Google in their discussion of a customer reliability engineer. This is something that's sort of spawned out of their site reliability engineer book. And it's about customer anxiety and the ability to try and reduce the customer anxiety and make it zero. That's something that we all sort of strive to. And then just reliability in general. As we move forward with, from our talk this morning, migrating into the fine world of multiple containers and multiple objects, as well as service providers that we now rely on, the customer anxiety and reliability becomes very important for customer success. So just thinking about how we can actually get some level of metric from our customers that we've just feedback to ourselves becomes very important, again, from a service provider like Google Cloud Computer or AWS. These things become critical. So I'm sure lots of folks have dealt with tire fires and trash bin fires in their in the world of operations. Anybody done operations in the past? Awesome, so that's a small handful of folks, awesome. So 3 a.m. calls in the morning, always a fun time. This is our third sort of driver here, and as you've seen from our, I've actually put in deploy, release, and operate. I'd like to say that operations now is, these are areas that they are also responsible for, again, as we move forward. In sort of a historical context, or maybe a classical context, a lot of sort of operation success metrics can be derived from, you know, network, platform, latency, things of that nature. As we move forward in relying on more cloud providers, CSPs, more objects to look at, Some of the metrics we're actually trying to capture are starting to change, and don't become that, you know, they've changed and they've also grown. So from a sort of a classic perspective, let's say we actually have like two nodes or two hosts. The typical amount of metrics would be maybe 150. Now let's say on those same two nodes, we have 100 containers. The amount of metrics essentially would be over 10,000. So you can see that, again, as we move forward, metrics and the number of metrics we're starting to receive is growing dramatically on the same sort of hardware. So again, this is data that we've pulled. The impetus of this data was the driver was actually trying to actually have from our mainline, we were actually trying to be, have something that was deployable. That was the goal. So what we actually tried to do was start to track just the simple success or failure as we were doing our pull requests and starting our actual build process. As you can see, there was a lot of challenges up front as we started to increase the number of jobs we had over time. Our failure came up, and we ended up having to sort of look at other data to figure out why are we having this, you know, the number of jobs are increasing from our deployment rate, success rate, but we're having a lot of failures. So what we ended up doing was actually going in and diving into different various test suites. And we found that a lot of our regression tests were kind of bloated, they were failing, there were challenges. The manual testing, we essentially had to rip out. So again, diving into other data, other information, forced us not only to sort of readjust how we were moving forward with our pipeline with this goal in mind, but also sort of refactoring our regression tests.
Impacting this rich number of failed deployments. So this really helped us zero in problems by looking at a number, a data point that wasn't directly telling us this was the problem, but it helped us sort of investigate further and isolate the problem and address it.
So again, back to our sort of our metrics pipeline. Again, from an operate perspective, I'd like to illustrate including deploy, release, and operate. Included some metrics here that we've found very useful. Again, I think really the purpose of this slide is to illustrate from a DevOps perspective the ownership of looking at these metrics, investigating these metrics has grown from not just looking at, again, latency and availability and am I pinging, is something up and running? We now need to take a step, a broader scope and look at What is happening with our, in our releases? What's happening in our deploys? What level of predictability do we actually have or gain? How is that deployment frequency? And then matching that up with our development success. So this is sort of a potentially a portmanteau from a metrics perspective of where development and operations will come together. So as we know, or as a lot of folks should know, when we talk about development success, develop, QA, deploy are the three main themes from a metrics perspective and a topology perspective. It's always sort of a, when we think about DevOps, I think we've heard something that's shippable. I think it's something that, so typically that infers just like speed, fast, quick. And we tend to leave out the quality perspective here. So development success, as we stated with develop, QA, and deploy, should invoke and include, just as important, good high quality. Now, a lot of times, as we've seen and can probably illustrate, in certain contracting environments, there is reward for speed and zero reward for quality. This happens all too often. So essentially, having some of these metrics in place that are highlighted in a meaningful manner to provide feedback to managers of those contracts to help adjust what these folks are actually doing.
Balance the constraints that the teams have and also the leadership's desire to say, go fast, build out more features. As we indicated in the previous slides, so we are dealing with legacy systems. It's not greenfield projects. We have 150 developers committing code to a common baseline. So it is a challenging environment. And we provide this visual chart to everybody in the common area of both leadership and teams, which sprint by sprint, it depicts how the teams are utilizing their capacity, their set capacity. And as you can see, not all of it is just about cranking out new features and cranking out code. There's technical debt concerns that need to be addressed. You need to surface that and reserve some capacity for that. maybe architectural improvements, new code, and in our case, because we're moving towards a you build it, your own mentality, team managed support, the dev teams, they're probably dealing with some of the production tickets and so forth. As you can see, we are dealing with lots of production problems. That's there, but having these metrics in place at least provides the visibility to both teams as well as leadership, so they don't keep pushing for saying new capability or whatever else your context is. But having how the capacity is being allocated among teams was powerful in so that management and teams understood that there's only whatever capacity you have, you balance it against the concerns that you need to deal with. And this sort of stuff, unfortunately, we're in an environment where we have a strong leadership pushing for DevOps, if you will. And all of it helps. Without leadership support, again, we wouldn't be experimenting with the kinds of things that we've been doing and talking about. Right? So that's
so again, just to sum up, I mean, from a development perspective, we're from the portmanteau of, you know, being responsible ideally to product all the way to production, we want to help emphasize that these key metrics and drivers do include development, QA, and deploy. Now, from a traditional CI/CD perspective, these metrics provide a lot of data to the dev team, as has been illustrated. And also provides them the ability to have more of an operation mindset as they move forward. So they can be responsible for that deploy. And they get feedback immediately so they can do something about it. So I think it was Wednesday, we attended Evan's session on part of his no project experience, and really his goal was really focusing on business outcomes. So Raj and I, just for S&G, said, hey, why don't we take a pass at this and see what this looks like? So this is, again, I'll give Evan all the credit here, because this was done during his talk, and we modified this a little bit. The goal here is to try to provide you guys, as we talk about a metric, it needs to be ideally tied to some sort of business objective. So our outcome title here is we're trying to provide a common platform for CI/CD, a platform as a service or a container as a service. Our measure here is team adoption rate. So we're kind of, from a owner perspective, we're taking this from the provider or the landlord of this service, right? We want to ensure we have some sort of, we're tracking adoption rate. So our current baseline is probably one team a month, and because we are not having any targets, we're abating the target piece. And so how do we actually measure team adoption rate? What does that look like? So Raj and I sort of noodled around and figured that probably features are important to folks. Form factor is probably something we want to keep track of, and the frequency. So below is just a little bit of sort of mock data that we put up. And as you'll see, sort of what makes this two-dimensional again and makes it a metric is the date. We want to keep track of the date. Event being, you know, just something as simple as a logon or actually doing an image stream into this pass or cast system. And then the form could be their IDE or maybe they're hitting the GUI to do this type of work. And then the actual count. So again, just a sort of representation of how perhaps you guys, as you move forward, looking at what business objective you've got or outcome that you're trying to achieve, just a simple exercise to move forward with to try and draw out some metrics that'll get you there. Oh, well, Raj, so, and were you part of that session?
Yeah.
So we pulled the metric out, or we pulled the target out, because at this stage for what we were trying to accomplish, we did not want to have a target. I mean, a target could be very, very important, I agree, especially if it's tied to some sort of financial aspect. But for this, we just want to measure our ongoing adoption rate. So tying it all together, from all of the context that we've got, really starting from business success to the other tail of customer success, The two key pieces, again, that tie it together really is the development and operation successes here. Again, balancing our speed and risk, quality, cost, setting our key indicators of success, again, reducing time to obtain and respond to our customer. So we've actually outlined, this is kind of a takeaway slide that hopefully folks can leverage and take advantage of, a bunch of different metrics to help promote some thought.
Choosing specific measures, trying it out, and seeing if it's working for us. So don't be intimidated by the number of measures. Again, there's no prescription for what's right for your organization. Pick and choose what makes sense, but make sure that you're always balancing different drivers and ensuring, why do you want more people to adopt our CI/CD platforms or some other larger business outcome, right? Making sure there's always multifaceted interventions.
So as we talked about earlier as well, with this, as we move forward with new technology, as we move forward with the ubiquitous movement to more virtualization, more cloud containerization, again, the number of objects we need to actually track and monitor and obtain metrics from is increasing, is very complex. And then if we couple it with all of our other success areas, that's a lot of data. And this is a framework that the adaption or source of this image is from The Art of Monitoring by Turnbull, James Turnbull. It kind of hacked it a little bit with the customer success areas to provide the where this data is coming from. Again, this is really, we're looking at data sources. We're looking at sort of a router or a transport mechanism. How do we are aggregating all of these events, again, that being quite large. And then what are the destinations? Is it just a storage? Maybe it's just security data or log data that needs to be stored away and maybe looked at a later date. Is this something that's we need real time or near real time action against? So is it alerting data? Is it thresholds that need to be set off? Whatever the case may be. So again, this is a framework that's been well used. A lot of folks such as Etsy and Spotify, even Google, have their own manifestations of this framework and essentially what that framework ends up looking from a display perspective and an alerting perspective. We're going to show you one that's from Capital One Labs. It's called Hygieia, and this is a representation of multiple data sources providing metrics in a single dashboard pane of view. So we're looking at data. Again, this is potentially sort of your CI/CD dashboard and the health of what's actually happening on your pipeline. So we're looking at, with the top, we're aggregating data from Jira that's giving us our sprint information. We're getting actually our Git or GitHub repo information. Again, Jenkins information, any sort of static code analysis that's going on, potentially performance data and deployment data. So again, we have a good snapshot that's easy to consume. Again, coming from multiple disparate sources. Yeah, this again is from Capital One Labs. The source here, you can actually download this. It's an open source tool. Yeah, you can. Yeah, if you already, and not only that, if you have these tool sets already in your pipeline, it's very simple to have them plugged up. Yeah. You can also create your own tool, your own sort of widgets. And your own data sources and integrate them into this tool as well, whatever makes sense.
All right, so we have a few minutes left. So just the key takeaways is, as I mentioned, there's lots of metrics out there. People consider metrics to be evil, but as I mentioned, it's useful if it's used in the right context. If it engenders some sort of behavior change, it's useful. As this quote from Goldratt says, if you measure me in an illogical way, expect illogical behavior and don't complain. So if you're just talking about velocity, give me more stories, well, what do you think is going to happen? I'm going to just estimate minus 20 points if it's wrong. I'm going to get higher velocity. I want higher test coverage, that's all I care about. Guess what's going to happen? I can write lots of bogus tests and increase coverage. So that's important. But don't be intimidated. There's lots and lots of metrics out there. Pick and choose what makes sense. And pick a small subset of metrics to start with. I think that's what we did, and we continue to add new metrics as well. And never target individuals. It's always the larger business outcome that you're after, that you're going to measure and shed some light on. Make sure the measures are across the different dimensions. We presented the four different driver dimensions, all the way from business success to customer success. The metric is never about one thing. It's always about balancing multiple drivers. Make sure you design metrics in that fashion. And then I would strongly suggest that use comparative measures. Metrics, by definition, are comparative. Ratchet up the tension across different drivers. You provide a deeper insights into the real dysfunction or the progress of important. And finally, make it visible. Right? Nobody is interacting with it, it's sort of useless. You want metrics, you want them to be simple, and you want to display it and have leadership and teams interact with it. Without it, it is pointless. Right? So that's important. And finally, just a couple of, so if you're just for those of you who are just starting out, start with the business outcomes that you're after. Pick one or two metrics, design those metrics, let the data provide the insights, and the insights themselves will generate the actions. Metrics by themselves, as my good friend George Dinwiddie, who's around here, says, the point of metrics is not to indicate the problem. It's to just shed some light in the general area of disturbance that you have, and then use those insights to drive action.
That's it. Thanks, guys. Yeah. Sure. Again, this is something that it came out of the Google Site Reliability Engineer work. And October of last year, they started talking about a customer reliability engineer. The idea is they wanted to actually have more success and a partnership with their customers on Google Cloud. So they brought up this concept of, a customer reliability engineer. And some of the things that they wanted to start talking about was anxiety. What is that customer anxiety? And their goal was to minimize, if there was a score, they want to minimize that score to essentially zero. And again, increase the partnership with that customer and see the success. To the point where I think they're experimenting with Google and the customer, if the customer's willing, having a partnership to the fact that when they're ready to do a release, they'll actually go through a PRR together. And it would be then up to Google to say yes or no.
What is the friction towards the developer?
interesting. So the question really was, a lot of the data is coming from the development team, and the concern is you're asking development teams to do too much. So in terms of the measures that we share, it really is all in our tier two. It wasn't really asking teams to do additional work, honestly. Right? And the coaches and those teams were the ones really, and the scrum masters were the ones collecting that data from their Jira and then providing that information. They're really not asking teams to really additional work. If anything, it was really to protect the team, to at least make their work visible. It's not about adding more work to them.
What is the method you validate when it comes back to the gaming?
So let me give you an example of that of metric that is. Oh, by the way, are we running out of time here? No, last question. Okay, so let me just give you an example of the test coverage one, right? So if you start to set high watermarks, this is what we did. That was a big mistake, right? We said from now on we want a high test coverage, whatever the percent was, 85, whatever. And in hindsight, that was a bad way for us to go about it. The failing bill saying if you don't meet 85. The adaptation we made instead was, instead of setting a high watermark, we started with where we are. Meaning, right now, we are at 40%. What we said is, we will never let our coverage drop below that. And over time, we wanted to make sure it is constantly increasing. So it's really it's the same data, but changing the context of how we're looking at it, right? So setting high watermark, we never let it fall below where we are, and in time, we want to make sure it's at 40, maybe by sprint, such and such is 45%. So we constantly push the needle further and further up instead of setting goals that are really setting up for failure and driving the wrong kind of behavior. Does that help at all? Yeah. All right. Well, thank you so much for your time. Yeah.